This conference will now be recorded.
Good evening, everyone. I'm glad to welcome Dr. R. Shubha, Head of the Department, CSE, who has been a great support to initiate this webinar. And I welcome our organizers, Mr. Sampat Kumar, Assistant Professor, CSE, and Ms. Gayatri, Assistant Professor, CSE, and all other faculty members. And now, I welcome our presenters and student friends and all other attendees who have joined us to enlighten this session. Once again, good evening all. Now, I affably invite Mrs. Gayatri, Assistant Professor.
Thank you, Shamila. Good evening, all. On behalf of our management, our Principal Madam Dr. Shubha Mohan Ram, Sri Ishwa College of Engineering, our HOD Dr. R. Shubha, Department of Computer Science and Engineering, our beloved faculties and student friends, I welcome you all for the Students Webinar Series Day 5 session. In our today's world, the way we interact with our devices has been dramatically changing. Instead of searching for information, we are chatting with digital assistants. And instead of looking to be entertained, we are expecting to be understood. Here, design thinking provides a solution-based approach to solve problems where the human needs are the starting point of developing any new project and also tackle complex problems. As time gets more complex and also the pace of change accelerates, people are feeling very stressed, fearful, and also unstable. This is where we can apply the concept of emotional intelligence, where emotional intelligence is the capacity to be aware of, understand, and express one's emotions, and also to handle interpersonal relationships empathetically. There are many benefits of emotional intelligence users where they can help us to navigate this pace of change and also ease our stressful feelings. I take this opportunity to introduce our student, Meghna, of third year Computer Science and Engineering, to take over the webinar session on the topic Design Thinking and Emotional Intelligence. Meghna is one of the placement coordinator who always keeps her busy schedule and also tackles the problems and manages to fix all those by following some of the blogs written in the Instagram on the same topic. Before we would like to hear from Meghna, I once again thank you all for your great support and let us motivate our students to grow more at higher levels during their career. Thank you. Now I call upon Meghna to hand over the session. Thank you.
Hello, am I audible?
Yeah.
Yes, you're audible.
Okay, fine. So good afternoon, everyone. My topic for the day, I'm Meghna J. Kansagra, and my topic for the day is design thinking and emotional intelligence. Okay, so this session, it's not like all the ordinary session, like where just I have to speak and you have to keep quiet and keep on listening what I'm speaking. Actually, you guys can unmute yourself and you guys can talk back to me whenever I ask something or whenever you feel like talking, because this topic is kind of that kind of topic. So I want you guys to interact. Let's have fun together and let's learn together. So there are two reasons I have chosen this topic. I'll tell you this reasons at end of the PPTA, and this very, very important to me and my life. So I just wanted to share that with you, and I'm so grateful that you guys are here today to listen to me and to be part of this journey. And there is a suspense element, like there is a surprise for you. What I think it's a greatest thing in design thinking and emotional intelligence, not only in this, in our daily lives as a person, everything. There's a small surprise element at the end of the PPT, so stay tuned till the last. We'll continue with our PPT. Okay. Sorry guys, I have some technical issue, just a second. Sorry guys, I had some technical issue. We can continue with our presentation, okay? Yeah. So yes, so design thinking, what do you guys think about what this term is? Like, so many of you here will know what is design thinking is. Hello. Yeah. Assuming that all the students over here are college students and going to work in a corporate, or who are striving to build a good design, good project, and who are already working in a project or working in a company, and they go through this scenario daily. Actually, this webinar is meant for that. I have designed a whole PPT keeping those people in mind. So yeah, coming to the topic, what is a good design? So what do you guys think a good design can be? Like, anyone can unmute yourself and answer.
Good design means what? You
open session. Yeah, okay, I'll see the comments.
Clue like
anything
that.
Which connects with end user. Okay, fine. So anything, thing is, sure. A good design is, as we got one response, anything with which connect the end user. Yeah, it's absolutely true. Yeah, I have three pictures in my slides. Okay, what do you guys think about this picture? Can anyone write something in comment section? Okay. Flexible to user, yeah. So this three things, okay. I'll anything, safety pin. It has all this three picture has a story behind it. I'm going to tell that story to you. Safety pin, actually, it was invented in 18th century, and still now it is meeting the end user need. Like every day of our life, we use safety pin. It's meeting the end user need. Like they. It's so 18th century, now we are in 21st century, and it's three centuries ahead. Then also it's, you know, meeting all the needs. So such a long time, then too, it's doing its function. So that's an example of good design. Second thing is South Indian meals. Actually, I really want you guys to come up for any stories like this for a South Indian meal, because this has got its unique story back then when design thinking was not even a term. Actually, South Indian meal, it gets a story from, like, see, now we are making idli, dosa, or paniaram, uttapam, anything. What we do is first process is that we are going to make a batter for it, right? And after making the batter, how much time it will take for it to get fermented? So it's a continuous process. First day, in olden days, we didn't have fridge, okay? So while we didn't have any fridge or something, it will take long time to get fermented. So after putting the batter, in first day, what can we make? We can just make idlis out of it because it won't be fermented so much. Next day, while it gets fermented a little bit, we can make a dosa out of it. Next day, it gets fermented better and we can make uttapam out of it. And next day, we can make a panyaram out of it. So the thing is, the whole process, like, you know, the usability of it, like we don't have to prepare anything new to make some new dish or something. It's just an iterative process. So it has got this unique story behind this. And moreover, South Indian meals, it has its unique nutritional value. Like everything, it's balanced food. So back then, they didn't even know what is design thinking is or what they intend. They didn't do it this intentionally, but this was this is meant to be a good design, which we can use it again and again for different reasons. So one, we saw about safety pin, like it should be long lasting. Our design should be long lasting and it should be effective to end user even after so much amount of time. Second thing is South Indian meals. It should have a iterative process and it should make sense even after days goes by. Next thing is Mumbai Dabbawalas. Actually, this has got this unique story. Thing is, Mumbai Dabbawalas, I think many of you would have heard about this. What these people do is, like, they collect dabbas. Dabbas in the sense tiffin in Hindi. So what they do is they collect those tiffin from their house, and they should that tiffin should reach to the person, if the husband is in office, that tiffin should reach to the husband. But what these people do is, in Mumbai traffic, there is lot of commotion, okay? You can't just as usual go. That it's the traffic is so high in lunchtime and all. So what they designed is, they'll have unique number for every dabbas. They'll have unique numbers, and there will be set of people. The dabbas will be passed from one person to another person. They won't even know, and there will be countless number of tiffins. But the thing is, the person who has to take that dabba will reach them correctly. So the flow of the design is very good there. So this is the third example for a good design. So what is a good design in the sense? It should meet both functional and aesthetic requirement. Functional requirement, means it should do its job. Aesthetic requirements means those additional touch which makes it feel good. That's called aesthetic requirement, okay? So this is how you can make a good design. Okay. Okay, so now coming to our buzzword for the today, design thinking. What does design thinking mean? How can we learn that? And is that a practical process? Can we learn design thinking or not? Everything, every doubts will be cleared. Design thinking. Actually, design thinking means nothing. Just two words: human-centered and future-focused. What it has to do is, any design you do, anything, anyhow you build a design, it should be human-centered. In the sense, it should meet end user's need. Person who is going to buy it, person who is going to use it, it should meet their needs. That is called human-centered. And future-focused is, like, you know, if that design is going to meet my need today, it is not important that it's going to meet my needs even tomorrow. Right? It should. So you have to keep it in mind that even after 5 years or 10 years or 15 years down the line, that design what you have done meets the user need. So we saw the example of safety pin, right? That is the best example, like future focused. It should be focused on the future as well as it should be appealing to the end user who is going to use. So that is the simple definition of design thinking. Actually, there are lots of definitions and we are going to see one by one, but these two terms defines design thinking. So there is a small Venn diagram you can see over here, right? So what this Venn diagram does? Actually, there are three elements: desirability, viability, and feasibility. So what they want is what we can do and what technology we have. This three combination put together, we get one small part, this area. If our design meets this area, our design is called to be a good design. You can in the sense, you have applied all the design thinking principle and you have built a good design. That's what it means. And we'll see how to build a good design in the future slides. But if your design meets these three criteria, your design is called to be a good design. Okay, now we are coming into the most interesting part of the day. And I would say if you understand this word, you can understand the you can understand people around you, what they do, what they feel, everything. You can understand the term design thinking in a better manner. What is emotional intelligence? You can understand everything if you just know this concept. Okay, how you define this term will emphasize everything. So here is a small thing. If Henry Ford had asked people what they wanted, they'll say faster horses. Back then in older centuries, when there were horses and not cars or anything, if you want to innovate something and you go and ask your customer, like, you know, what you want, or what will be better if you want to travel faster, what they'll say: I need a faster horse. This horse is, you know, too slow, so I can't travel much. See, if we go and ask your customer or end user what they want, you are not going to make a good design. So if Henry Ford asked the people what they wanted, they'll say faster horses. So now motors, cars won't even be existing. So you are not your user, and you can't go and ask your user what they want. What you have to do is empathize them. The term empathy means a lot. What does empathy mean? Considering other people's feelings, especially while making any decision. Like, if you want to make a good design, it's very, very important to know how they feel rather than what they say or what they want. It's all about feelings. How can you stand in someone else's shoe and realize what they want? That's what empathy means. Okay. So I think you have got a clear idea about the term empathy. We'll now see, everyone has doubt. Okay, now I want to understand everyone. I want to stand in other people's shoe. I'm really curious to empathize people. But what should I do to empathize people? It doesn't come, excuse me. It doesn't come in a very easy manner or something. It's not so easy to understand anyone's feeling or, you know, stand in someone else's shoe and, you know, empathize people and all. So what can we do to empathize people? Everyone has that question in their mind, right? Guys? Okay. So this is the thing. What can you do to empathize people? See, there is a simple map over here and what you can use to empathize people, okay? This is your user. In the middle, this person is your user, okay? What you have to do is you have to split in four columns. Excuse me. Okay. You have to split in four columns: what they say, what they think, what they do, and what they feel. Like, you know, what they say, in the sense, what are some quotes while you are speaking to them, what are some quotes or definition or words they used, right? In the session called say. what they think, what might be your user thinking at the time that your user is speaking to you or he is doing something, what he might be thinking. You can have a guess about it, right? What does he tell about you, his feelings or her feelings or her behavior, her beliefs, anything. So you can write that in think. What they do, what activities, behavior did you not notice? Like, you know, a person, every person has a unique behavior. Sorry, excuse me. What activities, behavior did you notice? Like what they are up to, what they want, what they are doing, everything. What they feel, what emotion might be your subject be feeling, like what your user be is feeling at that point of time. So just divide into four columns and write all this element. And this is not a one-time thing, okay? It's an iterative process. Like every time it keeps on updating. Like once if you do, you can't empathize a person. Every time you speak to them, every for whom you are designing, every time you speak to them, you have to do this process. And at the end, we'll come to a conclusion like what your user wants. So this is the method you can empathize people. Okay. Coming to the point, this is the main part of design thinking, okay? Like you want to build a good project, you want to build a good design, you want something. This is the roadmap. Like we have roadmaps for like business processes, everything, but this is the design thinking roadmap. You start with first one and you come to and you will completely know what is design thinking is, what we do and how to apply design thinking principles in your designs. Excuse me. So you are going to begin here. So you are that person, you are the superhero, you are going to build that design. What you are going to do next? First thing, very important thing is you have to observe your environment. Thinking that the whole, anything goes around you, anything that is changing around you, you to identify any opportunity in your environment and then designing it is a very good way. Like observation skills is the first thing to identify an opportunity. There are plenty of opportunities around us. They are waiting for us. They are seeking us. Just we have to be a very good observer, very good listener to identify the loopholes in the existing designs or to identify something that has a problem that we can find solution for. So identifying an opportunity is a first thing. Second thing is, see, if you identify some big opportunity or something and the scope for the project is very low, what you'll do? Like you are thinking of time traveling or something. So like you have identified this and you know you want to time travel or something, but the existing technology, does it support this? Or you know, will my project work 5 to 10 years down the line? Is it going to be feasible? You have to think of scope of your project. Then draft your design belief. See, you'll have certain things in your mind while you have thought of this idea or that design. What is that belief? What value you want to contribute to the society? That makes a difference. Then you have to plan your thing. You have to do a research, identify insights, establish design criteria, and then comes the main ideal topic is brainstorming ideas. After that, you have done research enough in amount of research and you think your project idea is going to work, what you have to do is brainstorm your idea. You have a problem statement, but you are not going to find a solution for it immediately. If you think one solution is going to work, that's wrong. You have to think of so many solutions, so many ideas in your mind, and then come to a conclusion. In later slides, we'll see how we are going to find a solution for it. How will we have a best solution out of everything we have? But brainstorming idea is very crucial in this. Next thing is develop concepts. So what technical concepts you need, what business oriented concepts you need, you have to develop those concepts. After that, you have to do a rapid prototyping. In the sense, before launching it into the market, what you have to do is give it to the customers, your end users, your target audiences, and see whether it's working. You will find so many blind spots, like you wouldn't have even thought about that. Rectify those things in your design, and after that, that's called beta testing. After that, launch it in your market. So that will give a perfect design out of design thinking process. So we'll see in later slides, like how can we do this. Okay. The 5-5 concept. Actually, this concept is very simple concept, and you can apply this in anywhere of your life. See, I have done this in Corona breakdown, this one of the example. But what you can do is, you can see, you have to believe that if you know a problem, a specific problem, very, very in specified manner, you can find solution for it. There is solution for everything in this world. Just the thing is, you have to know the right problem. So 5-why concept is one such exercise that you can go deep inside your problem, and you can find roots of your problem. So in this concept, we learn how to go to roots of a problem so we can find solution for those. So thing is, see, I have done this. I feel frustrated and disconnected in this lockdown days. My emotions are taking over me. But why I'm doing this? Because my emotions are taking over me due to less of human interaction and sudden changes. Why is that happening? I'm not keeping myself busy and no social life. Why that is happening? Laziness and procrastination. Why that is happening? Because I don't know where my life is going, and changes in the world are unpredictable. And why those changes are unpredictable? Why I'm not able to keep track of my life? So I know what is the basic problem of me. Like, I'm not able to keep track of my daily life. That's why I'm not able to arrive at the solution. So I know the root cause of my problem, so I can arrive at the solution in very faster manner, right? So this is, if you do this, you'll come to, like, it can be 4-why or 2-why also, and it can extend up to 8-whys also. But the main thing, the main root of this exercise is you have to arrive at the deepest part of your problem. That's where you can find your solutions. So doing this, you can arrive at the problem, and after that, we can find the solution. And your problem should be so minute that in an ice cream stick, like we eat ice cream, like that stick is very small. We should be able to write that problem in that ice cream stick. It should be so specific and so narrowed down. Okay. So this is John. What this John is, now we'll have one scenario type thing. So we'll meet John, and I'll introduce you to John. So what this John does is, he has currently been working in a corporate, in a very big firm. That firm believes that innovation and research is main part of developing a community or society. So the heads of this firm has given John a task. What this John has to do is, he has to develop a project that meets the society needs, and it should be very human-centered. So this John is going to develop a project, and he's going to guide his teammates, okay? So now let's see how that John is developing his project. So first is journey mapping. This is a very crucial part of design thinking, okay? Like, journey mapping is from starting to end, what a customer faces. Like, if you go to a website or if you go to a store, how do you feel inside that store? How like you are been waiting in billing line, or how that store appears to you, everything. What a customer goes from start to end, that is called a journey mapping. In this journey mapping, what John is doing is, he's going to map the negative things that his customer is facing. In the sense, all the negative experiences, like, you know, standing in a queue or not having enough concentration from the managers and all. So all the negative experience of his project, he's going to write down. So in this journey mapping thing, he'll come to know what is the exact problem of his targeted customers. So brainstorming. Now John knows everything. These are the problems of my customers. He has done this 5-Y concept and he has come to a brief idea and brief problem statement. Now what this John is doing is he's going to teammates and he's very enthusiastic about it. We have to do brainstorming on this. Like, we have to get so many solutions out of it and we have to find a best solution out of this. So what he's doing is he's going to his teammates and telling, okay, let's do brainstorming on this project. So the team lead, the John is the team lead and these are the employees. So what his employee is telling is, should we hit our brains by storm? That's what the employee had in his mind while hearing the term brainstorming. So should you hit your brain by storm? That's what. So thing is, brainstorming can be as crazy as this. You don't have to limit your ideas. You don't have to limit yourself while brainstorming. It can be anything fictional, non-fictional, existing, non-existing, anything. Any weird idea that comes to your mind on this topic is it can be written in brainstorming. So everyone are discussing on the problem statement, all are giving their crazy weird ideas, and you know, they have come up with so many ideas. The whole board is filled up with the ideas for the one problem. They have written so many crazy solutions for it. So can we implement all those crazy solutions? Like, is it really practically possible to implement all this solution for it, and which is the best solution for that problem? So here we come. How to do is, we have got the whole board of ideas about that problem statement, and we are really confused which one to choose, because everything seems nice to us and everything is super fun and super crazy. Now what we are going to choose, what will be the best for our firm, and what is really going to work? So this is it. We have to choose all the ideas. We have to first list it down in a very neat fashion. And what we have to do is, we have to give them weight, like 10 grams, 100 grams, and 1000 grams. If that idea is really good, we are going to give them 1000 grams. If that is okay, we are going to give them 10 grams. And it's okay, not that great, we are going to give 10 grams. But how? There is a technique called QBL. Quick, bold, and long lasting. In this three criteria, we are going to give them this weight. What quick means? Quick means in how much time we are able to develop this project. Like, if this project has a technology which is not even existing now, it is not possible for us to build that project, right? So it should be quick, within something like 3 or 4 months or 1 year or 2 years. That idea should be in working prototyping stage. So it should be quick enough. Bold is that it should give a jerk to your end customer. Like, you know, if it launches in the market, it should be like, oh yes, this thing, like their life should, it should be very unique, and it should be something different from everything existing in the market. And last thing is long lasting. Long lasting in the sense, even after 5 to 10 years, you should be sure enough that nothing like this is going to come up in the market. Like, you know, this one will meet the end user need for at least for this period of time. So for that period of time, at least you can earn the revenue out of it, and that will be existing in your market. You know, this is the I remember one example, like, you know, Apple phones, they are the best example for this. Nothing has come in market as Apple phones, because it is quick. They have developed it for so many years. Bold, like, there is no no phone in the market that gives a aesthetic feel, a good feel. Like if you have an Apple phone in your hand, you know, generally it's a very big brand. So it is very unique and long lasting. So many years have passed. It has got its value. It has got its model in the market. So this is the best example for it. Okay. So after doing this QBL technique, John has come to an end that what idea will work for him. So he has he goes to his higher authorities and tell, this is the findings we have done from this, and this is the problem, and this is the solution for it. Everyone appreciates him, and he is a hero, superhero of his dream now. So next thing we are going to jump into is know a person, okay? So you want to understand a person, you want to empathize a person, you want to understand your target audiences, you want to understand your end user. Everything, you have to know that person first. Like what is their background, what is their challenges faced, what is their doubts, fears, inspiration, aspirations, interests, motivation, everything. I bet you, like, you know, take this template and you'll have someone in your mind while you think, like, that person, or that person you understand the most. There will be one person in this entire universe who you understand the most. Do this for that person, okay? Do this for that person, and I bet you that you won't be able to even complete the half of the parameters, because, you know, always we understand a person in a very superficial way, what we want to understand about that person, but not what that person is really is. What are their doubts, fears, challenges, background, everything. Not in a first chance or first time you are filling this template, you will understand a person. So this is an iterative method to understand any person better. If you keep on doing this, keep on filling this, only then you will come to a basic idea. And this will change every time you write. If it's the same person also, this column, the content you write will change every time. So this is an iterative method to understand a person better. This is the universally accepted thing that, you know, to build a persona for anyone. You can build this persona profile for yourself also to understand yourself better. So only if you understand anyone better, you empathize anyone better, only then you can build a good design. Okay. We'll go with storytelling now. See, so this is the best example I've ever heard for shifting the thinking. In the sense, you want to, anytime you, what to say, like, you are focusing on something and the solution will be somewhere else. Like, if you keep on focusing on the problem, sometimes you can't get a solution. So at that time, what you have to do is just shift your thinking. Like, just think in other way around so that you can really get to the solution. So this is the thing. The story of Aika, the story of Aika. In the sense, this is a furniture making company, okay? Established in later 90s. And here, this person, he is a founder of it. So one day he thought, like, you know, I want to expand my business. He had a small shop in his town for furnitures. He thought, I want to expand my business. But what he can do to expand his business? All the rents, manpower, he didn't have any investment. All the rents, manpower, everything was taking lot of amount, lot of energy and lot of money. So what he can do to expand his business without having a proper investment, without having proper, maintenance and proper showroom for that. What can he do to make it spread whole worldwide? So not thinking of just the problem and how to find a solution for it, how he can expand his showroom and all around the world. What he did is simple thing, okay? See, if you set up showrooms in all around the world, it's going to take you rent, it's going to take you manpower, it's going to take you money. But what if you have just a warehouse where you make all the furnitures and keep it, and you know, ship it at person's home, like assemble there at the person's home. So this was the first company which made ready to assemble furnitures. Like they didn't have any showrooms, nothing. They manufactured at their warehouse, and they transported it in person home, and their employee will go and set up that furniture. So they didn't have anything, showroom, money, power, nothing. Just they manufactured and they put it there. So it saved a lot of time, and their business expanded in the way that they can't even imagine. In something down the 3 to 4 years, it was a world famous known company, and still now they are the best furniture making company. Okay, we'll come to the next part of our session, emotional intelligence. See, everything we do, we think, like our cognitive abilities, like our IQ, is very much important than am I audible? Okay. It's very much important than our emotional intelligence. Actually, what is emotional intelligence, and why we are talking about this today, and why, what is it has to do with our IQ? I'll answer all this question. One basic thing is, like, if you are very strong in some technical part, or you have very good cognitive abilities, and you are not a people person, like you are not able to mingle with people, you are not able to understand yourself, you are not able to understand people around you, you are not able to empathize them, then all your cognitive abilities are in vain. Like they will not make any sense. So this is why emotional intelligence is important. Actually, there is a book called HBR on Leadership. HBR is a book published by Harvard University. And in that book, on leadership is what a best leader needs. So in that, the first thing they have stated is emotional intelligence. They have stated so very firmly that emotional intelligence is very much important than your IQ. Like, there are two people, okay? If those two people, one is with very good IQ, very good cognitive ability, and other one is average, but he has very good emotional intelligence, the people with IQ and emotional intelligence is supposed to make a good career out of his life because he has people skills. So this is what they have stated in Harvard Business School reviews. And while coming to emotional intelligence, it's simple definition, like ability to recognize your own emotions, understand them, and see how they affect those around you. Like, you have to understand your emotions first, how you feel, how you react to situation, and how those emotions are affecting people around you. That is simple definition of emotional intelligence. It's just developing strong people skill. So next thing is this. How can your emotional intelligence be learned? Like, there is one question, okay? All these soft skills, are people born with this leadership skills, or you know, they have it naturally in them, or they have learned that? Like, you know, no one has answers for that. Is that natural skills, or they have learned over a period of time? But many people say that emotional intelligence can be learned. Everything, it comes out of practice. Emotional intelligence can be learned, and there is tools, techniques to learn those skills. So now we'll see about this. See, there is an employee with a very negative emotional intelligence. Their emotional intelligence is very low. He keeps shouting on their employees, doesn't agree with anyone, doesn't listen to anyone, have strong opinion, and disagrees with everyone around them. He blames everyone. If he does a mistake, he's blaming people, and he doesn't make himself accountable for anything. Do you think you can work with people like this? Okay. So thing is, it's very hard to cope up with people with low intelligence, low emotional intelligence. If you are, so, how can you? What can you do to develop them, and what are the tools and techniques? Yes, this is it. So empathy, self-awareness, social skills, self-regulation, and motivation. These are the five parameters that defines your emotional intelligence. Okay, so we'll look at them one by one. What is self-actualization or self-awareness means? The ability to recognize and understand your moods, emotions, and what emotions they drive us and the effect of those emotions on the people around you. So basically, it is what you feel and how those feelings are affecting the people around you. So next thing is self-regulation. What is self-regulation actually? You are facing some disruptive emotion, or you are not in a good mood, or you want to argue, or you want to shout at it, or you don't agree with those people. In those moments, how can you shift your mind? How can you regulate yourself? That is basically self-control, or control of your emotion and living your highest values in any time. Like, your value is you are being kind and gentle to everyone. You have to live that value even in at your worst time. And if you do some mistake, you are accountable for it. You have to accept it. That is called self-regulation. And motivation is very simple, being driven to achieve something. And social skill is really important thing. Just because, see, if you managing relationships and moving along with people so that you can direct themselves in a good direction, and you can direct yourself too, like being in a healthy environment and growing together. If you don't have people around you whom you can't help, or they can't help you, that's going to reflect in a very negative manner. So having a social skills, having a network of people, good people, that really adds up to your emotional intelligence. And the buzzword for today, empathy. Empathy is a simple thing, understanding other people emotional makeup, like how they feel, how they react, what they want, what they like, what they feel. Everything empathy comprises of that, basically standing in someone's shoes. Okay, so these are the five elements of emotional intelligence and what it has to do with design thinking. See guys, it's very simple. Like, you know, I didn't read this anywhere, or this is the concept I came upon on my own, because I was learning these two topics simultaneously. Like, both the topics I was reading simultaneously, and I was practicing simultaneously. So I got this connection between these two. See, people with low emotional intelligence can't cope up with anyone around them. They'll be always, you know, frustrated with their self. So you can't expect them to be good to people around them, understand them, and empathize anyone. So if you have really low intelligence, low emotional intelligence, it is very likely that, you know, you can't build up, you can't contribute to the project you are doing, or you can't be along with the team. And design thinking is everything about a team. Like, it's everything a teamwork when it comes to corporate. And if you are applying design thinking in corporates, everything is about teamwork. So emotional intelligence, empathy, it has a very big impact in the way you think and the way you interact with people. So emotional intelligence is very crucial part of design thinking. Okay. So, you know, we spoke about being a leader, being emotional, being having a high emotional intelligence, and, you know, having high emotional intelligence and having high emotional intelligence and learning skills, applying design thinking, everything, where to apply, how to apply, everything we learned. But this single thing is very important in anyone's life. Thing is, you know, mastering a skill or being average in everything. Like, see, it's called as horizontal expansion and vertical expansion extension. Thing is, if you are good, very good in something, like, see, if you take your now in CSA department, if you tell like I'm really good at coding or something, the coding languages are going to change with like from time to time. Like now we are using C, Java and Python. In next few years, there might be some other language which will be very advanced than this. But the base, your foundation, your problem solving skills, your reasoning skills, logical reasoning skills should be so well that you can master anything. So you have to master the foundation. I'm not telling you have to be in certain direction, certain area that you can say, yes, I am a master of it and I know everything about that field. Only if you are master of something, practically you can teach everyone and they are going to believe you. No one is going to believe you without you having some practical knowledge on it. So, you know, it's always good to have a master in something and know about every other field in an average scale. So, anything, you have to be master of one to be a good leader or to teach people to do anything. You have to be a master of one skill, so you have to take up that skill and you have to find ways to master it using all these concepts we learned. Okay, so we spoke about empathy, spoke about emotional intelligence, everything. But you know, everything, all these things has a base. See, we all are very good at communicating our feelings, our emotions, what we feel about a thing, or you know, public speaking or doing anything, conveying ourselves, expressing ourselves. But you know, it is very, very hard to listen to someone, to know what they are feeling, empathizing them and understanding that person in very crucial situation where we are arguing on something or any particular situation. Like every time we look into that point that we have to express ourselves, we have to present ourselves, we have to make them believe our point. But anytime we are not ready to listen to the other person. So how can we be an active listener? Only if you are going to be an active listener, you will know about that other person, what they feel, and based on that, you can improve your emotional intelligence and you don't have to go in some destructive arguments or something. Just it requires is listening. So there are four simple steps, okay? Like what to have to do to be a good listener. First thing is not leading the conversation. Thing is, if someone is trying to convey their feelings or what they are feeling, what their emotions are, what you have to do is you don't have to lead the conversation. You don't have to start, I'm feeling like that, I'm feeling like this. You just have to respond to that person and keep actively listening what that person is saying. You have to make them lead that conversation. Second thing is suspending judgments on other people. Like we all human beings have done masters in judging some other person who is talking to us, okay? Anytime, any two sentences they speak and we already have the image what they are going to say next. So, you know, suspending judgments on anyone, like if someone is speaking to you and if you are judging that person or forming some image in your mind, automatically you're not going to listen what other person is saying further. You are going to be on your own imagination cycle and you are going to give that person a stamp. Yes, this person is like that, that person is like this, and this is what he feels. You are going to understand him only from your point of view, not from their point of view. So while anything, you can have your own judgments, your opinions, but not while doing a conversation. After that conversation, okay? So you have to suspend judgments when you are speaking or listening to someone. The third thing is focusing on emotions as well as the content. Like, you know, sometimes we all say things we don't mean to, or we let out words and we, you know, just say say the words that we don't mean, but our emotions will be different. So while we are listening to a person, we have to know both the words they are speaking and what emotionally they are feeling, what they are feeling while, like, if you are seeing that person in personal, like face to face, like, you will know by their reaction, facial reaction, body language, what that person is trying to convey and what are the emotion of that person. So it's very easy to know both the emotion as well as the content. So just by content of that person, you can't judge that person, okay, he or she said like that and this is it. So you have to know both emotion and the content. And last and most important thing is reflecting accurately what he or she had understood. In the sense, the whole conversation is over and you have some image, you have listened actively, the whole part of the thing. But what you have to do is, you have to just in two or three words, you have three sentences, you have to ask that person, this is what I understood from your conversation. Did you mean to say something like this? So this is the entire thing. So you understand that you have understood that person right, and you don't have anything negative judgments on them. So this is the four really easy steps. And as we practice, as we, you know, subconsciously, anytime you interrupt someone in, who is speaking, like, you have to make yourself remind yourself that you have to be an active listener. And as the time goes, if you do this practice again and again, you will be an excellent listener and you won't have any difficulties to understand the opposite person. So yes, this is the most favorite exercise I do every day for something around past 1 year. To just, you know, this has changed my entire life, I can say. Like, it's very simple, okay? Anything, the whole day goes by and, you know, you make so many decisions consciously or subconsciously, so many things goes around you and so many incidents happens in entire day. We won't even have time to reflect on those incidents or what happened, how did we react or what the other person said. The simple thing is, you know, when you, at the end of the day, just write down everything you feel, everything that happened in your day, every decision you made consciously or subconsciously, write down everything in a piece of paper. What happens is, as you keep on doing this, at one point of life, you know, you develop your emotional intelligence in a very high scale. Like, you start understanding people, you don't say words you don't mean to, or you make decision in a very better way. So while you do this, there will be some amount of change, and you know, first and foremost thing is, you'll stop overthinking. Like, all the thoughts will be at stop when you go to sleep. That's a very important thing. But, you know, you'll develop your emotional intelligence skills in a manner that, you know, you'll be very much into people and you'll understand them in a very better way. So this is a very good exercise for self-actualization and self-regulation. It's a really good exercise to develop your empathy skills also. So I was... this is one thing. And I was telling you about the surprise element at the starting of the PPT, right? I just want you guys to
see that.
Am I audible? Guys, sorry, actually the audio has some problem. Hello, am I audible? Please, anyone can reply. Hello, am I audible? Please, anyone can reply in comment section.
Yes, Meghna. Yes, okay. Yes, you're audible.
Sorry, there is some video problem, I guess, in this. There is some audio problem. I'll share you this story link. Actually, this is what the surprise element I had. Actually, storytelling is something that everyone can, you know, make a part of their daily life. Like, you itself, you, as a person, you are a story. You are a story to the world, to a brand or something. Everything is about storytelling. So this is the best video I have seen so far in my life about storytelling. It explains how your story has to be, how you can connect with audience in very specific manner. And, you know, it has explained all the elements about storytelling. So I'll just share the link, and I'm so sorry for the inconvenience. There was no audio sound, I guess. And I'll share you the link, and that's the best thing you can ever see. Like, please let me know after seeing that, how did you feel about it? So we have a small description how a good story should be. Like, you know, a good story should solve a problem, create a cause. You have to have a cause for the audience to buy your product, and give the right message. Like, you know, what message, what values you want to spread, that value should be correctly conveyed to your audience. Next thing is, you should know who are your audience. That's when you can build a good story. After that, start to end, you have to have some connectivity between them. And there should be some suspense part, and that should make sense to audience who are listening. So that whole thing makes up a good story. So that's it. Thank you so much, guys, for tuning in with me till the last. Genuinely, thank you so much. And there are two reasons for this webinar I hosted. The first thing is, it's exactly 1 year I started learning design thinking, exactly like 12th of June. So, you know, from 1 year I'm practicing and learning design thinking and emotional intelligence. It's a big opportunity for me to convey this to all you people and spread the message of design thinking. And second thing is, I have Instagram page. Like, it's been 50 to 51 days I'm working on this to spread message of design thinking and emotional intelligence continuously, daily. So these are the two reasons I've been working for it. And I want you all guys to know what is this things means and how this can change your life. So this is a great opportunity for me. Thank you so much, guys. You are open for questions.
That was a wonderful session. Thank you, Ms. Meghna. And now it's time for Q&A session. If you have any queries, kindly post it up in the chat box. And here is your first question, Ms. Meghna. And the question is from Ajay Desigan. And the question is, can you brief your experience before and after design thinking?
Yeah, sure. Like, you know, one thing I keep on telling people I meet is, design thinking has changed my life to the way I've not even imagined it. So before design thinking, everything was very normal. Like, you know, I used to look at things, look at people, look at everything, all the situation in a very normal and a usual perspective. But after learning all this design thinking principles, actually there are a lot more than this. I was forced to do this in 1 hour. Like, I wanted to give my best in this 1 hour. So these are the topics I have chosen to deliver. But there is lots in design thinking that you can learn and improve it. So, seeing people, behaving with people, understanding people, observing the environment, listening to people, everything has changed. Like the life itself, the thing, the way I think, everything has changed for me.
Thank you. And here is your next question, and the question is from Sanjeev. The question is, okay, can you give example for DT in real time, and please describe the difference between design thinking and CT?
I don't get what CT means. Like, can you please explain, Sanjeev?
CT
okay,
means
creative thinking. Okay, fine. So creative thinking is just you are thinking from an end user perspective. Okay, thing is, you are okay. I'll give you a, as all our computer science student, you are developing an application. Okay, website or application, anything. You are designing a UX. Okay, user experience, UX and UI. Creative thinking means, like, you know, you will apply those elements to make it look even better, and you know, to make it look more creative and more appealing to people. But design thinking in other way is, like, you know, what your whole user experience is like, you know, how the time they spend, the, you know, how they can navigate between your website elements, everything. Design thinking is whole experience and not just the end part. Creative thinking, in my opinion, it's just the end result. Did I answer your question, Sanjeev? Like, you know, design thinking in real life, if you want to know, there are really good examples. As I gave, like, all the South Indian meals, Mumbai Dabbawala, and the story of Aika. And there are so many case studies for design thinking. If you want, I can give you send those materials personally. But there was a time constraint, I was not able to do. But there are a lot of practical applications for this too. And giving a short example, our website and our user experience will differentiate this, I think, creative thinking and design thinking.
Thank you. And here is your next question from Mr. M.V. Krishna Prasad. And if I'm not wrong, he's asking about how did you choose this topic for this webinar session?
Yeah, so nice question, Krishna. Like, thing is, I'm practicing design thinking for last 1 year. And, you know, I'm doing this on my daily basis, as I told you before. That's why, you know, this kind of my passion to teach everyone about this and, you know, spread the ideas and principles of design thinking. So this was the obvious thing to choose for webinar.
Thank you. And here is your next question from Ms. Hinduja. And the question is, how does emotional intelligence can be interlinked with design thinking? Could you please guide us with an example?
I think I explained that in PPT, I guess. Like, see, anyone with, I'll explain you again. Emotional intelligence and design thinking is very, like, design thinking is a superset, emotional intelligence is a superset, and design thinking is a subset of it. Consider it in this way. People with high emotional intelligence, only those people who have empathy, self-actualization, observation, social skills, only those people can mingle with team, you know, observe their environment in very friendly and have a different perspective about everything. So only those people can apply design thinking principles in their project or in their daily life, or, you know, just the way they think. So, you know, emotional intelligence is based for everything you do, not just for design thinking, I guess. Did I answer your question, Sinduja?
Thank you.
Okay.
And here is your next question from Mr. Ajay Deshigan. And the question is, like, is there any course to fully learn design thinking?
Yes, there is a course to learn design thinking, the course of life. Like, you know, you can't learn design thinking in going through some webinars or going through some videos or something. You know, you can just learn the gist, the principles, and, you know, the tools we used in design thinking. But, you know, you can learn design thinking only if you apply in your practical life. So your life is the best course you can ever learn on design thinking, I guess. Did
Thank
I answer
you, Thank you. And here is your next question from Mr. Sanjeev. And he was satisfied with your answer, but still adding to that, he is asking you to collaborate it with our real-time problems. For example, he's stating COVID-19.
Okay, I had one slide called 5Y principles, right? The whole scenario, it was based on my COVID-19 experience and that is very small tool in design thinking, the 5Y concept, and how I applied that concept in my real life. If you want, I can show that slide. Just a second. Yeah, this one is a slide. So this is my entire experience on COVID-19 and how I came to a particular problem, specific problem what I was facing. So even this is a design thinking tool. I think Gokulnath has one. Actually, he was my teammate while we are learning design thinking together. So he asked me to give example of rat and pipe. Actually, there is one small story of rat and pipe. I don't remember in a very correct way. Like, I can give it sometime else because I just remember parts of it. I just don't want to deliver it in a random way.
Thank you, Ms. Mehana. And now we'll end up this Q&A session. And now I affably invite Mrs. Gayatri, Assistant Professor CSC, to deliver a vote of thanks.
Thank you, Sharmila. First of all, I need to appreciate you, Meghana, that all your slides were your own creative and also very innovative one.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. And you have started with the topic on empathy with a very good pictorial representation. And also all these steps you have been explained in a very good manner to improve our design for growth. And the 5Y concepts are very well said. And all the people in our today's life are suffering from the same problem, that why are we like this in this busy world? That too, you explained your session with a person called John. It is a very awesome one. And how to know the person through personal life, personal profile, and also how we can develop our emotional intelligence level through journaling topic. It is a very good habit to be followed by all, I think.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes.
Thank you so much. Yes, thank you so much to give this opportunity.
Okay. I just want to appreciate her because to give this kind of webinar to all our student friends, where she came as a different volunteer student rather than other students, because they all pay their topic in their own subject knowledge, not like her. That's why I appreciate her. Then I wholeheartedly thank our department, our management, our Department of Computer Science and Engineering to give us an opportunity to conduct such a wonderful student webinar session for our students to explore their ideas and share their knowledge and also their experience to other students. Once again, I thank you all for your active participation. I would require the same support from all of you for other days too. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ma'am, the feedback link. Okay, ma'am.
Yes, I have posted the feedback link, so all our participants can look into it and submit this feedback form.
Thank you so much, guys.
Yes, ma'am, we'll wait for another 2 minutes so that you can copy your feedback link, you can submit your feedback form. Also, I forgot to mention Sharmila. Thank you, Sharmila, for hosting this wonderful session. Thank you all. We can end our session. Thank you.